It's Sunday morning, and I have been tossing around some things this past week, and what we've been teaching on has led me into this thinking. I've taught on these things many times before, but I'm talking to you about prophecy and the end of time. I believe that we are very close to the end of all things. I've felt like since I was a little kid that I would be alive when Jesus comes. Now, I'm 77. I'll be 78 this May. That's not very far away. As to whether I will be alive, that's up to God. But we are in, due to the signs that's going on in the world, our economy, for one thing, there's four judgments that God said He would bring on people, and we are the people of God in the world. There's four signs that God said, four judgments that God said He would bring. He'd bring the sword, and the sword is going to equate with war. And the famine is going to equate with weather, the economy, and anything that has to do with food, and our weather upheaval. We've gone through a February that I have never seen in Tennessee. I've never seen this warm. In fact, I went online last night, and I thought, well, I'll just look up. I used to keep up with the hottest years, and they said that the hottest year to date was, and this was taken in 2016, whoever wrote this article. The hottest year to that date was 2015, and they said 2016 was on the way at the point they were doing that in the middle of 2016 to surpass 2015 into temperature, average temperature rising. You think, well, what's the big deal about that? There's a whole lot of big deal about that, because we have to have, we have a balanced ecological system in our society. And whenever we start, we're manufacturing so much since the Industrial Revolution, which came about in the late 1800s, beginning in the 1900s, when they begin to have all of these inventions, and we're pulling all of the natural resources out of the ground, we're actually taking out more than we can, we're expending more than we can afford. And these scientists, what really gets me, everybody will go online and play games, and you've got access to some of the most brilliant scientists in all the world online. And you can go on and ask any number of questions when you're Googling. What do the scientists think about? Don't just say what is natural disaster about, or say what do the scientists think about natural disaster? And they will tell you all about hurricanes, earthquakes, and the Bible says there's going to be earthquakes in diverse or many places at the end of time. Diverse means diverse. Diverse places. Earthquakes. You're going to have volcanoes. Do y'all know, you probably don't know this, we've got a super volcano sitting right in the middle of the United States in Montana. They say in its way past due to blow again. In the early 1800s it blew, and it will be devastating to America when it blows. They say it's very dangerous to be up there. Would they have no idea when it's going to happen? It's under the earth, and we got what they call a super volcano in Montana. The glaciers in Montana are melting. People don't even know that. Instead, they're wanting to play games and want to investigate what they can do to have fun. In 1850, when they come up with Glacier National Park, I don't think they actually named it that until about 1910. In Glacier National Park, you know what a glacier is? A glacier is a great big sheet of ice covering a mountain or covering a side of a mountain, and it's one big solid piece of ice. They had 150 glaciers when they came up with the idea of Glacier National Park. They're melting. We're down to 125 in Montana. Now, excuse me, not 125, 25. We're down to 25 now. That's what they call big glaciers, big enough to be called glaciers. They say that all of the ice, we've got ice caps that are melting. You got the northern ice cap or North Pole. Have you ever looked at a map and you see all that ice up there? Well, a lot of it's melting. You got Greenland over here, and great big hunks, I mean the size of a city, of ice are falling off into the sea. We have problems, and people just want to make excuse. Now, whenever you have a scientist saying something, Professor Frank Finner, he was a scientist out in New Mexico. He died in 2010. He said, our nation, not just our nation, but the world, will not be able to survive in 100 years. We will go into a state of annihilation. He said he believed that the human beings will be extinct 100 years from about the time that he died. We will not, he said, you're not going to be able to live in the world. You say, what do you mean things are heating up? I've been following the El Nino. You're familiar with El Nino, aren't you? That means the child in Spanish. El Nino, the reason they called it that was because at that time of the year, it came in December, naming it after the Christ child. They said El Nino is just off the coast of Argentina, and it is a track of sea water where they say that those trade winds cease to blow. Now, I wonder who is in charge of trade winds. You think that may be God? They quit blowing there, the trade winds. It would come in December. They called it El Nino. And I started looking at El Nino in the late 60s and early 70s, long before our ex-president, Al Gore, wrote his book on global warming. Started looking at that. It is an area of land, an area of the sea that's larger than the United States. And they say in that area, when El Nino hits, now El Nino is beginning to go throughout the world, coming in different phases. They say El Nino, when the waters evaporate, that they go into the stratosphere, and they go up here, and they're carried by these winds around the world, and they're causing havoc all over the world. They're causing... It's causing droughts in Australia. It's causing no snow in the middle of our midlands over, like in Kansas. We have to have snow to have nitrogen. I had a biologist come here, and I talked to him a lot. And he said, you have to have so much snow because it produces the nitrogen in order to have crops in our meadowlands. And when you go out in the West where we grow all these crops, and we're not treating the earth right. I'm not on a I'm not on a kick to try to tell you to fix things, because it's not fixable according to the scientists. It's not going to happen. This Professor Finner, he said we are at the end of our world. He said within 100 years, this nation, this world will not be able to support the people. And you say, what's the big deal about that? They say that the most that we can afford to go, when you're talking about an average, you can get this on the internet, but you're also going to get, you're going to have people calling us, you and I, doomsday preachers, doomsday. Well, that's exactly what I am. I'm a doomsday prophet. I do not believe the world is so messed up. The preachers are corrupt in their preaching. We have problems we cannot fix in our economy. It's not fixable. There's one professor at Boston College. He says we are already past the place of no return. We can't return. We're never going to fix it. He's an economics expert. These guys are saying it's not going to happen. We're not coming out of this. I believe, and not only that, but the fact that Israel is back, Israel is back from 2,600 years of being scattered all over the earth. This has to do with the sword, the famine, the pestilence. We have more diseases. You can go online and you can Google center disease control out of Atlanta, and they'll tell you we've got things that's going on in the world. You think we're having a pretty easy time in America? We are. But if you go to foreign countries, I believe Scott will even verify this, that down in Ecuador, they got diseases that we don't even know how to overcome. And this has to happen. I don't even know how to approach this. There's so many points to it. I was going to read to you some of these things up here. Where will we be in 2050? And they'll go into this telling you things that you probably don't want to hear. And when you see, when you go online, you'll have the professors and the doctors and the brilliant scientists saying one thing. And then you'll have all of these comments under it, like you have on your on the internet when you're looking up something, and all these geniuses say, well, this professor is sick, or this doctor of virology, or this biochemist, he's gotten crazy in his old age. That's because they don't want to give up the world. If you lose your life in this life, you'll save it hereafter. It just shows you reading those comments on those professors and those scientists. The people that are commenting back, oh no, this is not going to happen. It's the same thing as standing at the gate or the door of Noah's Ark when Noah's preaching. And that's what I feel like. I feel like Jeremiah preaching in the streets and the gates of the city saying, the end is on the way. People don't want to hear that. If you call yourself a doomsday prophet, they'll say, well, you are nutty, you're crazy. They're going to say that about us, aren't they? They said it about Jeremiah. They said Noah was crazy. Well, Noah didn't go down to a river and start building an ark. Why would he need to do that when the flood is going to be in his backyard? He just went outside and started building an ark. You don't even stop and think about that. Noah wasn't trying to be seen, but the people were saying, he's nuts, he's crazy. Look where he's building that big old boat. Huh? Yeah. Anyway, let me read you a couple of things just out of these papers. You could, and some of these brilliant professors, their words don't mean anything, but we know Israel is back after 2,600 years of captivity, and the Bible says concerning that, and you can match that up with all of this disease, with all of this El Nino, with all of this upheaval of volcanoes and hurricanes and tornadoes. The tornado that hit Moore, Oklahoma here a few years ago, they said that was a super tornado. It was 4 miles wide, and the winds were 200 miles an hour, and they said that is the strongest tornado that they have any idea of that's ever hit the earth anywhere in the world. That's a lot of tornado. Take your time to go online and ask simple questions. What do scientists think about global warming? What do scientists think about national or international disasters in the world? And they'll tell you. Some of them will say, there's no way out, there's no hope. Now, I believe that because Israel's coming back, this generation will not pass away till it'll all be fulfilled. It's the same generation where we're seeing all of this natural disasters throughout the world. Just look up natural disasters. What do scientists think about them? They're going to tell you things that you will never hear on the news. Never. And the news media does not want to put that out where people can hear it, because if you do, they're afraid of some panic, national pandemic situation in America. I'm trying to teach, but here's the point. It don't matter what these people comment about these scientists. It doesn't matter. It matters what this book says, right here. And we've got in this book, what does the Bible say is going to happen at the end of time when it comes to the weather? Well, let's look back over here in Luke 21. I was going to read some of this. They're talking about the ice caps are melting. The ice caps, northern, southern, Arctica, they're melting. There's big hunks of ice. Let me ask you this. See, this doesn't mean a lot to you. Didn't mean a lot to me when I first heard it. But if everything increases 6 degrees, they said up to 6 degrees centigrade. They said if it increases another 6 degrees centigrade, we will not be able to live in the world. Stop and think. If you have ice caps and you got glaciers all over the world, we have an ecological system that says we have to have so much ice, so much water. Everything has to be balanced together. God built this as an orderly arrangement. We are the ones that's destroying it. Even one of the scientists said it doesn't matter whether it's a natural warming, which they said 250,000 years ago we had a natural warming. Well, what difference does it make if it's natural warming? Whose call is causing that? God's causing it. So it doesn't matter if man's doing it or whether it's just a natural thing that's going on. It's still happening. You can't come up and the Democrats and the Republicans want to argue about who's doing it. You get in a car wreck and you get killed and your family's sitting out there fighting over whose fault it was. Well, I don't know, but they're dead. That's what's going on. Look here in Luke. In Luke 21. Do you know that the Bible tells us how God's going to destroy the world? Tells us how he's going to do it. He destroyed it by water over there in Genesis 7 and 8. Noah built the ark in the 6th chapter, and he built it in 7 and 8, and in the 9th chapter he comes out of the ark. Started by water, and he promised, I'll never destroy the earth by water again. But he didn't say anything back there about fire and heat. And he tells us how he's going to destroy the Babylonian system. How does he say he's going to do it? You've heard me preach on it. But first of all, Revelation 17 and 5, Babylon mothered all idolatry. Babylon was the mother of harlots. I have been wondering, how can I get people's attention? They're not hardly paying attention to a lot of the things I'm saying. The preachers are lying. The preachers are saying, accept Christ as your Savior, and that's the way to heaven. That's not true. They're saying, pray a sinner's prayer, and you get to go to heaven. That's not true. They're preaching Christmas is Jesus' birthday, and it is not. It was the birthday of Hercules and Tammuz and all the sun gods in the ancient world. That's not true. They're preaching all these things that are absolutely not true. Baptism is not H2O, it's blood. I don't have time to go into all of that along with it, but the apostasy is here. The apostasy goes along with all of this. Apostasy, Israel coming back, the preachers lying in the apostasy, apostasis, a removal of standing upright, or removal of the daily cross from starostasis, we get staros, which is the word cross. And Paul said, men hate the cross of Christ, which is the daily cross. Men hate the cross of Christ because their God is their belly. The problem with the world is man's belly. That's the problem. That is an old ancient Epicurean term, the belly. In the first century, everyone knew what that was. That was an Epicurean term, one of the most popular philosophers of the day. And when they said the belly, they said that was all sensual desires in yourself, and you could fill up self. That's all the problem in the world. The world is racing 100 miles an hour after the flesh. That's what they're going after. And what it has done, it has consumed the land. It's consumed the air. We've got all kinds of signs that you can go online and look up sun flares, sunspots, and they'll tell you about these great big long flames that's coming out of the sun. I don't know how many miles, thousands of miles coming out of the center of the sun. That's affecting our earth. I wonder who's doing that. That's God. We're living under the judgment of God right now. That's the problem with our economy. Man is selfish. If you stop and think of all the great conquerors of the world, whether it's Napoleon or Attila the Hun, whoever it is, it's because they want more land, more self, more of everything they can get to rule it. They don't want to share anything with anybody. When Jesus said, all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, people don't want to do that. Now, look here, and I'll just remind you, Luke 21, the Bible says, and it includes natural disasters here in this prophecy, along with the Jews coming back from all over the world where they've been scattered. We've been talking about the Jews. They went after self gods. They went after idols for 500 years under kings, and they went after about 300 years under judges. And God scattered them all over the world, and he begins to bring all this judgment on the world. And at the end of time, they will come back. And at the end of time, all these things are going to be going on. The sword, the famine, the pestilence, and the beast will be ruling at the end of time. And it's going to take a world ruling system to try to conquer all the wars we have, all the famine, the economy in the world that's upside down, and the weather's helping that, and we're helping the weather. And we're helping to destroy. It sounds like I'm making a speech for one of these left-wing group of people that go out and they sit in for, I'm not, and they sit in against the pollution of lakes and rivers and the air, and they say, quit doing this, quit doing that. I'm not doing that. I'm telling you, we've already reached the point of no return. We've already gone to past the place of no return with our economy. That's what the best economists tell us. It's not going to happen. And the men who study the weather patterns, they say we're already past where we should have been. We're not turning it around. I challenge you to go online. And people say, look, I've had people say, well, online, they don't always tell the truth. You have to know the difference between the right people and the wrong people. Usually those guys that are not doctors or professors, and if you're an honest scientist and you're honest with yourself, you have to study something and say, that's what it is, and look at it, and look it in the eye. You can't come up and say, well, that ain't going to happen because I think I want to have a better life. These are people who want to save their lives. They say, well, that's not going to happen. You have to be able to differentiate the people who are trying to tell you the truth and the ones that want to defend their money and their stuff and their things. If you're out there to defend yourself, well, I'm young and I got kids and I want to have a long life. That's not going to stop the judgment of God from happening, is it? The best thing to do with your kids is tell them the truth every day. So there's going to be kids in the world when the end comes, isn't there? There are going to be children. There are going to be teenagers. And just because you don't want your family to be in trouble at the end of time is not going to stop God's orderly arrangement from happening. I got so many things to read, I wish I could read them all, but I'm just going to show you. God is telling us how he's going to destroy things. Look here in Luke 21. I'm going to read the verse about Israel, and then we're going to go right into some verses about the world problems. Verse 24, and they, the Jews, shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations. And that began in 586 B.C. when Nebuchadnezzar carried them off into captivity. And they've been in captivity ever since until 1948, May 14th, when they became a nation again. And they've been trodden down of the Gentiles. And then they got Jerusalem back in the Six-Day War, June 5th through June 10th, 1967. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until June 5th through June 10th, 1967. Well, that's when it happened. Until the times of the Gentile rule over them is fulfilled. And the previous verses are about the Gentiles ruling the Jews because they went after these other gods. Until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled, and there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon. Now, whether you like it or not, the moon and the sun controls the tides. The moon, the sun has something to do with the tides, and mostly the moon controls the tides that come in and out. We talk about the tide coming in and out. It controls that. But when we are polluting the oceans, the Bible teaches that the fish in the sea, everything is going to be dead at the end of time. We're on the way. Mary and I, we eat a lot of fish since we try to eat healthy. And we ate orange roughy for a long time. We started going to the store and they say there's a shortage of it. They can't catch them anymore. And I began to look and on the TV, every time some documentary comes on about animals in Africa, the elephants are going to be extinct before long. I got a list here of endangered species. You see, are we getting into ecological saving of the earth? No, that's not going to happen. Things are going to happen the way God wants it to happen. But it'll tell you the black rhinoceros, the Bornean gargantuan, the elephant of Borneo, the cotton top tamarin, the gorilla. African wild dogs are on the endangered list. Penguins are on the endangered list. Tortoise, the giant tortoise, is on the endangered list. You say, what do I have to do with that? when the animals start dying and all the fish in the sea start dying, people are going to be dying. The tortoise, the dingo, the discus, the dolphin, the donkey, the dragonfly, the eagle, elephant, falcon, ferret. These are all on the endangered species list. They're dwindling down to nearly nothing. The fox, the frog. They said you can't hardly find frogs anymore, and they used to be everywhere. Fur seal, gecko. But those guys don't like that, that run that insurance company. Giant clam, gibbon, the Gila monster, the glowworm, the gopher, gorilla, great white shark, gray reef shark, the gray seal, the hammerhead shark, the dragon, those big dragons on those South Sea Islands, the black bears on the endangered list, bottlenose dolphin, the buffalo, the bull shark, the bullfrog, butterflies. I saw that on the internet, that the monarch butterflies on the endangered list, beautiful as they are. All of these, chameleon. You say, does that have to do with me? Yeah, it has to do with all of this back here. Has to do with endangered. It has to do with our ecology. If we can't fish, and we can't bring out fish, everything is in a chain reaction. This is affecting this, is affecting this, is affecting this, and it comes all the way back to us. And if we are heating up, they say 6 degrees centigrade, and we won't be able to live on the earth. One of the professors said, we are past the point of no return. And they say that about our economy. We owe $18.5 trillion. How can that be paid off? It's not possible. We can't pay it off. If they don't even charge us any interest, we can't pay that off in 10,000 years. Somebody's going to have to move on the scene and say, I've got the answers for all these problems, the sword, the famine, the pestilence, and the beast. Now look here. He says in verse 25, and there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity. No way out. That's what the scientists are telling us already. That's what this economics professor tells us at Boston University. He says, we are past the point of no return. We cannot redeem our economy. It's too late. And that's what the scientists tell us about our world corruption. All of this, the Bible calls this birth pangs for Christ's coming. Men's hearts failing them for fear. We're not quite there yet. But we could be there overnight. If we wake up, I've got a book called Greenhouse Effect. And this is a man and his wife, and they're scientists. And they said, where we are with our world disaster at the door, they said, we're like a giant boulder. They said, we're like a giant boulder on the side of a mountain being held there by a pebble down here. So when that, whatever it takes to get rid of that pebble, he said, our environmental system is going to come crashing down, and we don't even know the results and how quick it can happen. I believe God is watching over his orderly arrangement. And when it comes down, it could come down overnight. I'm quoting from these professors out of these very respectable, brilliant man. They don't look forward to a long earth. Could happen like this Professor Finnish says. He says it can happen. And if it starts happening, if we can't live on the earth in 100 years, how hot is it going to be in 2050? Where are we headed in 2030, 40? They talk about it, these guys say, and nobody does anything about it. Now, distress of nations with perplexity. Men's hearts failing them for fear for looking after those things which are coming up on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, not when they've been happening 100 or 200 years, when they start, then look up and lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh. And he said, behold, and he spake to them, behold the fig tree and the trees. Israel was always called a fig tree. When they shall shoot forth, you see and know that yourselves that summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise ye, when ye shall see these things come to pass, know that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation, it actually says her generation, A-U-T-A, the church, this generation of the church will not, aute, comes from auto, which means him, but this is the Ada, is her generation, shall not pass away until all these prophecies are fulfilled. Now, let me show you how God says he's going to destroy the earth. Go over here to Revelation. We're talking more about ecology and economy today. I wish I had everything before me that I've looked at on the internet. It's very frightening. I hope you can get scared. You go outside in a nice end of February day, and it's real nice out there. Do you realize that that nice weather is the curse of God? The weather's going up and down. We've got friends in Wisconsin. They say, we don't get the snow we used to get. We don't get it here in Tennessee. We used to have 4, 5, 6 snows in the winter, and we had a lot of them were 6 and 7 inches. I remember walking around in the snow in 1981, walking through the snow to show people a house, and I'd be up in snow up to my calf. We don't have that anymore. And you got to have snow for the crops. It's the nitrogen in the snow that produces the fruits and the vegetables. That's what this biologist that come here told me. Now, look over here in Revelation 16. God will tell you how he's going to destroy it. Revelation, you've got 7 angels. 7 angels over in Revelation. The first chapter, you got 7 stars on the right hand of Christ. The 7 stars are the 7 angels of the 7 churches. Angel is the word angelos, A-G-G-E-L-O-S. It means messenger. 7 messengers of the 7 churches. Well, the 7 churches, let me say it one more time. 7 is the word Sheba in the Greek. Comes from the word S-H-E-B-U-A-H. Shebuah is the word to, it's the word oath. Now, when you can take an oath to God, that's not the night you begin to realize that you believe the Lord. That's after you go through trial and tribulation, years of trial and tribulation. That word Shebuah means 2, 7, oneself. And there's 7 things you have to add to your faith in 2 Peter 1 and 5, starting there. 7 is the, this is the word cardinal number. 7 means a number of completion. When you become completed, then you are being sevened. Well, the 7 angels, you're going to find them all through the book of Revelation. If the 7 angels are here, the church is here, because the 7 candlesticks are the 7 churches of Asia. It's the church being sevened. And when you look at the candlesticks from the top, it is the Star of David. That's 7. And I've gone through this teaching through Revelation. Now, and you find these 7 angels in 8. chapter 8, 9, and 10, and they've got seven trumpets. Trumpets are voices, so this would be the refined church preaching the truth. It's like what I'm saying right here, right now. When you get seven, you'll tell the truth no matter how much it hurts, no matter how much it bothers the people of God. Now, I want to show you how God says He's going to destroy the earth. When we think of the earth and the evil part of the earth and sin in the earth, what do you think of? You think of Babylon, the mother of harlots. She was founded on self. You know that it's nothing but self that causes all of these problems we have in the earth when it comes to national disasters. We're just polluting everything. I'm not saying quit polluting. You're not going to do that. You're not going to come out of self until God convicts your heart. Is the world going to come out of self? No. The world is Babylonian. The world is the many that will not repent. It's the many going into the Broadway, isn't it? And you're not expecting. Do I expect people to change this? No. Are they going to change what these professors, these doctors of science, are they going to change and do what they say? No, they're not going to. They're going to keep on sinning until God's got the world in an upheaval. God's put it in an upheaval. When you talk about global warming, we put so many emissions into the air that the structure of the emissions we put in the air, chlorofluorocarbons, that's the out of the spray cans. That's why they changed the spray in the spray cans. They took the chlorofluorocarbons out of that. That was, I don't know, 8 or 10, 12 years ago when you sprayed with spray cans. They took that spray gas out of it so they couldn't go up and sit on the top of the earth. I asked a doctor, acquaintance of mine down in Nashville, I said, is the global warming really real? Are we having a problem with the gases? He said, yes, we're having a problem. He said, down in South America, there's a place where those gases have eaten a hole in the in our ozone. What do you call it?
Ozone.
Eating a hole in the ozone, and he said they have more cancer cases down there than anywhere in the world. What they're doing, all these gases, they can come into the earth, but they can't get out because of the structure, the molecular structure of the gases. So everything's heating up. And people who want to fight that, it's usually the left-wing Democrat people who want to fight that. So it's not happening. And then they've got their problems too. It's the Republicans that want to... I'm getting mixed up. The Democrat left, when I say left, that's the liberal people. They don't want to admit all this is going on, but they'll tell the Republicans, you need to quit driving your big SUVs while they drive theirs. And one complains against the other. You have to understand, there is facts, and there's the people in the world that want their own way. They just want their sin, and they don't care. Now look here, in the 15th chapter, you see these same angels here. And I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having the seven last plagues. Now these are the plagues of God that they're going to pour out upon the earth. This is very figurative language. It don't mean little angels are going to come and start pouring them out. It has to do with what's going on here. All of this problem with our ozone, all this problem with the weather, and with the famine having to do with the economy and the food in the world. Look here. And I saw as it was a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark, Mark of the beast is not some mark you take on your head. Mark is the word karagma. Karagma. Karagma comes from the word, it means an authority. It comes from the word karax. Karax means a stake on a boundary line. That stake was set up in the garden when God said, "Thou shalt not eat of this tree in the midst of the garden." And the tree in the midst, what God was saying, there's a stake on the boundary line. You can't eat of that tree there in the garden. In the midst. Eve looked at the tree and saw a tree that was good for food, pleasant to the eye, make her wise. John said, all that's in the world, all in the world. Now remember the word demon, daemonion. Daemonion means to distribute fortunes. And that's what's causing all of the problems in the world. Men wanting what they want. Lust of their flesh. All that's in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and pride of life. The Bible says that's all the problems we got. Pride of life. You can list every sin under this right here. In the mark of the beast, Eve saw in the tree these things right here. Lust, epithumia. Epithumia means to long for or to breathe hard after and superimpose upon your life that which is forbidden. And this is man's only problem right here. It started in the garden, and it's still here, and it's blossoming into full bloom at the end of time. You can put along with the Jews coming back from the sword. You can put the sword, the famine, the pestilence. You can put all the problems we're having with the fish in the sea. The Bible says they're all going to be dying. Let me skip over from chapter 15 to 16. This is where these angels are pouring out their judgment, or the preachers of the, not the preachers of the Baptist church, the Pentecostal church, Church of Christ. The preachers are preaching these things to the world. Look here in verse 1. I heard a great voice. This is chapter 16, 1. A great voice out of the temple saying to the seven angels, go your ways and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. There's no answer for the sword, the famine, the pestilence, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear. We hadn't come quite to that point yet. We could be there in a year or two or three or five or ten. The first angel went out and poured out his vial upon the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worshipped his image. I'm not going to go into all this because I don't have time. The second angel poured out his vial upon the sea, and it became the blood of a dead man, and every living soul died in the sea. Do you think this is some figurative thing here? The fish are already starting to die in certain areas of the world. They're all, many of them are on the endangered list, species list. And the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and fountains and waters, and they became blood. To become blood means to die. They become blood. It don't mean all the rivers in the world are going to turn red. It means the fish and all the animals therein are going to be dying because of an ecological twisted system upon the earth. And I heard the angel of the water say, thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and washed and shall be, because thou hast judged thus. For they have shed the blood of the saints and prophets, and thou hast given them blood to drink. There we are, that old saying, blood to drink. To drink blood meant to undergo a death. For they are worthy. And I heard another out of the altar say, even so, Lord, God Almighty, true and righteous in thy judgments. The fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and the power was given unto him to scorch men with fire. What does God have to say to us to get our attention? This don't mean just the evil man. This means the good men too. And we're all going to be on the earth when it rains on the just. It rains on the unjust at the same time. When it rains fire or heat upon one, it's going to rain it on everyone. And men were scorched with a great heat. Now, the Bible says the time's going to come where men are going to be scorched with heat and be dying from it. And blaspheme. Now, this is what God says. These guys that give answers, all those answers right below one of these science reports, those answers will go on for page after page after page. Some scientists will say there's no way out. We're past the point of no return. And it can be happening any time. And these people will go on for 50 pages saying, oh, that ain't going to happen. That ain't going to happen. What's wrong with this scientist? Is he crazy now? You look at the man, this man Finner, this Dr. Finner, he helped conquer and find the vaccine for smallpox. He was given the Albert Einstein Award for science one year. This is an extremely intelligent man. And he was old when he brought this up, after he researched for years, when he said, we're not going to live over another 100 years on the earth. He said, it's going at a breakneck speed. We're too far gone to turn around. So expect your kids 20 years from now to be experiencing this 30 years from now. You may be old and about ready to die, but expect them to have to experience it. The best thing you can do with your kids is teach them the truth at home as well as at church. Then he says, and they were scorched with great heat and blasphemed the name of God, which hath power over these plagues, and they repented not to give him glory. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness, and then gnawed their tongues for pain. There's going to be some kind of pain here upon the earth. There's going to be some kind of heat here upon the earth for these people during this tribulation. Let me give you another verse here real quick before I lose sight of it. Well, let me just read verse 11. They blaspheme God of heaven because of their pains, because of the loss of their money, because of the... When this begins to happen, everybody's going to lose everything. This is going to be what Matthew talked about, what Jesus talked about in Matthew. And their sores and repented not of their deeds. Men who are vessels of wrath won't repent when God starts raining all these judgments on the earth. Look at Matthew 24. God is telling us how he's going to destroy all this. Matthew 24. I don't feel like I'm even giving you the fullness of this message. I'd have to read a whole lot of these things. I've got books by very scholarly men, but the book that I go to see if God's going to bring fire upon the earth and heat upon the earth is this one sitting in front of me. Now, if you're a believer, and most people here are, we're going to have to suffer along with it. You don't like that? Tell God about it. I can't stop the judgment of God, and I'm not going to paint a pretty picture. I believe it's a lot deeper than what I'm giving you. When you read, what's amazing, you can read some authority. It's kind of like sitting in a class with Mike, and Mike's teaching you calculus, and you're sitting out there saying, I don't believe that. I think I'm going to get along without this. Well, you're not if it's required in whatever you're studying. You're going to have it. You're going to have to deal with the truth. America doesn't want to deal with the truth. Not just the preachers. They don't want to deal with science. And actually what's happening. I just challenge the whole church to go home and start just, you can Google anything about scientists. How do scientists look at the global warming? How do scientists, how many volcanoes do we have? They're going to tell you you've got them all over the world and they're bubbling, waiting to explode. But if 100 years from now, if the world is uninhabitable, we won't be here. God's already written the last chapter for us about how he's going to come for us and take us out of here. Look here in Matthew 24. Look at verse 21. For there shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. We haven't hit that yet. We could be right on the cusp of it. We could be just right on the verge of going into this very bad weather situation. When they say the earth is heating up, they mean they take an average. They add up all the temperature all year long, and they divide it by 365, what it is average each day. And what they're saying, you may be just 2 degrees higher than you were the year before, but that's an astronomical amount when you add a degree in 1 year. They said we are multiplying at such a rate, they don't know what to do about it. Let me read something here.
Can you read verse 22?
Verse
23?
22. What did he say?
22.
Oh, 22. And except those days be shortened, there shall no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. I've been looking at this that as though it was no elect flesh be saved. But it says no flesh. No flesh is going to be saved because what is all this is about? Is it about the ecology? I believe it absolutely is. Because everything in nature comes from God. It's funny to me, the people will say, well, the acts of nature. Well, insurance companies call it acts of God. Insurance companies seem to know more than some guy that calls it acts of nature. Now, go back over here. I believe heat and fire are a sign of the end in the Bible. Go back over here to Revelation 8. I just mentioned this verse going through it real fast. I'm going to just stop and look at it. So here are these same seven angels, the same seven preachers of the seven churches, talking about refined preachers. At the end of time, there's going to be some preachers preaching. One of them's going to be me. Chapter 8, verse 1, and when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. I don't want to comment on this because this has to do with the temple. And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of the saints. The prayers of the saints are the type of the incense that was offered in the temple, this altar of incense up to God. Everything over in the Old Testament is a shadow. The New Testament is the very image. The incense is the type of the prayers of the saints. This is all very figurative language. The smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and earthquake. What's going on in Revelation is the sign of the end. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets, a trumpet was a voice. We find that in the fourth chapter of Revelation, in the first chapter of Revelation. John said, I heard a voice behind me like the sound of a trumpet. And prepared themselves to sound. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees were burned up. Oh, think that's heat? I think so. Fire. And all green grass was burnt up. And the second angel sounded, as it were a great mountain burning with fire. What was the mountain? You look at McLintock and Strong, look at the M volume, and look up Mount, M-O-U-N-T. It will tell you that a mountain was a capital city of an empire. You have two mountains in Scripture. They're at war with each other. One is Zion. That's Israel. The other is Babylon, the mother of harlots. God says, my people are Zion. That's the mountain of God. That's where the temple sits. And Babylon is the mother of all idolatry. Harlotry means idolatry. Idolatry is the word E-I-D-O-L-O-L-A-T-R-E-I-A. It means to serve. Latruo, what you see. Means to serve. That's self, isn't it? It all goes back to self. It all goes back to the outer man and the inner man. The outer man. A man that has no inner man doesn't have any Christ in him. And we have to wrestle with self, outer man. And the inner man is Christ in you, birthed by the will of God in you. That's predestination. Now, so you see these, and the second angel sounded, as it were a great mountain burning with fire, was cast into the sea. Every time you find the term cast into the sea, that's a picture of destruction. The Bible says this mountain is cast into the sea. A mountain was a capital city. Horns was a term for power or a capital city, and heavens was a term for the head of an empire. So all of these have basically the same meaning. It was four horns that carried Israel into captivity: Babylon, Persia, Greece, and then Rome, there in Zechariah, the first chapter, the last two verses there of that chapter. And the heavens, that was ruling power. Let's look at the mountain. If there's a mountain that's cast into the sea, remember the man of the Gadarenes, he had D-A-I-M-O-N-I-Z-O-M-A-I. Daimonion means to distribute fortunes, and demonizomai is the word possessed with devils. With devils. And when you look that up in McLintock and Strong, it'll tell you it means to be insane. When you're insane, you cannot think correctly. You cannot think intellectually. You cannot think right. Your thinking is twisted. You can't think rationally. If you look up insane in Webster Dictionary, it'll tell you the inability to think rationally. The world can't think rational because they are wanting to distribute fortunes. Well, when I can't tell you the whole story. I watched myself preaching on this morning on the TV. But these demonizomai, the craziness of the man, was cast into the swine. There's no such thing as demon. Demon, daemonion, means to distribute fortunes. That's what's in the tree over there in Genesis, the third chapter. It's self. And every time you find Babylon being cast into the sea, that's what's happening here. A mountain burnt, cast into the sea. When Jesus says to the... He says over there to Peter and John, if you say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea. Cast into the sea was a term for destruction of something evil. Cast into the sea. When you find the burnt mountain of Babylon in Revelation, the 18th chapter, Babylon sinks into the sea. So you got Babylon here, which is the doctrine of self, sinking into the sea, and it's being burnt. Look over here, and I hope you can follow this. If you've been coming a long time, you can follow me with this pretty easy. Look over here in Jeremiah. Burnt mountain, what would that be? Stop and think about it. What is the mountain? It's Babylon, mother of harlots, and she was founded on self. Self is going to be cast in the sea. How is that going to be? All the things that thy soul lusted after are going to be destroyed by this burning world. And it can actually be a literal burning. It can be heat, the earth heating up to the point that men cannot harvest fish from the sea. They can't harvest out here in the Midwest. They can't harvest anything because it's too hot to work, or they've run out of resources. And that's going to happen at the end of time. And the Bible speaks of those of us that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord. Remember the word remain? Perilipa. Survive. We which are alive and survive the great onslaught. Could it be the onslaught of the earth in its demise? Could it be God's onslaught? And it will also be the onslaught of evil men out here as they attack us. According to the church will be attacked in Daniel 7. The church is going to be under attack in Revelation 13. We're going to be attacked by the world, and at the same time we're going to be suffering in the world with the unbeliever until the end. Those of us that are alive and survive unto the coming of the Lord, we're headed towards bad times, people. Good times are not ahead. Only good times we're going to have is fellowshipping with one another. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now look at over here in Jeremiah. Not Jeremiah. Over here in... where was I going? Oh. Oh, yeah, Jeremiah. Jeremiah's right. I've got all these things on my mind. All right, Jeremiah, the 50th chapter. It's talking about the destruction of Babylon in Jeremiah 50 and 51. It talks about the destruction of Babylon. This is ancient Babylon in Isaiah 13 and 14, it's talking about the destruction of Babylon in these two end chapters of Jeremiah. And you got several places talking about the destruction of Babylon. Look here what it calls Babylon. Verse 29, this is where Cyrus is coming in and destroying Babylon. Call together the archers against Babylon, all ye that bend the bow, camp against it round about, let none thereof escape. Recompense her according to her work, according to all that she hath done. Do unto her, for she hath been proud against the Lord. Proud, let us make us a name. That's their doctrine. Behold, I am against thee, thou most proud, in verse 31, And then he says over here in chapter 51, verse 24, I will render unto Babylon, to all the inhabitants of Chaldea, all their evil that they have done in Zion, in your sight, saith the Lord. Behold, I am against thee, O destroying mountain, destroying capital city. How have they destroyed the world? By leading people into, let us make us a name, all that's in the world, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and pride of life. Where do you find that? Everywhere in the world. Is it alive and well in America? It leads America. And then he says, in following in that verse, saith the Lord, which destroys all the earth, I will stretch out mine hand upon thee and roll thee down from the rocks, and I will make thee a burnt mountain, a burnt capital city. That will mean all that she distributes will burn. Look over here in Revelation 18. You'll see the burning of Babylon over here. When it's talking about Babylon burning, it's not talking about rocks and dirt. It's talking about the people and their desires. Isn't that the world? Isn't that what all of this disaster of all of these that our ecology is bringing upon us, and we're contributors to it. The Democrats are saying, well, we need to stop the manufacture of all these SUVs, and the Republicans are saying, no, we just need to cut spending to overcome this problem with all these factories emitting all of this. It's funny to me listen to those guys talk. Honestly, I agree with you Democrats that the earth is heating up, and the Republicans say it's not. But you Democrats don't understand. There's no answer, no way out. It's going to happen until the end. People say, you must be a Democrat. You say the earth's heating up. No, I see it heating up, and there's no way out. I hate to have to say this, but there's no good future for you. Not spirit, not in the flesh. There is spiritually. That's why we need one another. Every time we have a crazy summer and it's real hot, or things don't bloom right, or we have a... You know what this is happening right now? Somebody tell me what's happening with the warm coming in February. One word.
Orion?
It's Orion being... It's Pleiades being loosed. God tells Job, can you bind the sweet influences of Pleiades and loose the bands of Orion? Orion was said to take the sap down in the winter. You can get this out of McClintock and Strong. Just look up Pleiades, look up Orion. The rabbis said that the sap would go down in the vine for the winter. And that Orion took it down, and that Pleiades brought it up in the spring. That's because the Pleiades, the seven stars, God says, don't worship the seven stars, worship him who maketh the seven stars and Orion. Yeah. That Amos, the fifth chapter. That's what we worship, him that maketh seven stars. They said that Pleiades brought the sap up into the vine, and the sweet influences of Pleiades wasn't the stars influencing your life. Sweet influences when you smell the new mown hay, which smells so good in the spring. God says, what I'll do, I will loose the bands of Orion in the middle of winter and allow the crops to start springing up and the daffodils start budding and the fruit trees start budding, and I'll hit you with a freeze and I'll kill your food. Famine. That's what I think of when it's as warm as it's been all February this year.
Is a peach tree blooming?
Huh?
There's a peach tree blooming.
And if they start blooming and God hits us with a freeze in the 1st of March, then what happens is the prices of the fruit in Florida goes up because of that. And God can, He can play with us with His weather and cause us to want to repent, if you know what that's about. How much time do I have, Mike?
19.
All right. Look over here. So He says, I'm going to make you a burnt mountain. God is telling us He's going to heat things up, isn't it? What He's saying? Or do you want to believe God and say, that's all figurative? No, look over here in Revelation 18. Now, I teach on this extensively. I'm not being able to hit it much this morning. Revelation 18. I believe the earth is heating up. What amazes me, Alaska's melting. I mean, the tundra is melting. The tundra is the hard ground in Alaska. It's frozen hard, solid. You can go online. I had a film on it. The title of it was Alaska's Melting. It was on an old VCR tape. I don't know what in the world happened to it. But it shows forests that are leaning where the tundra is melting. They're leaning about 45 degrees, all the trees in the forest, because it's melting and the forests are sinking. And it shows these houses in certain towns in Alaska where the tundra, they built their houses on the tundra, that hard ice ground, and they're sinking. And the second story house is right here at ground level. They're just sinking into the earth. And these, whoever they are, the left wing Democrats are saying, or the right wing Republicans, I can't even hardly keep them apart anymore. They're saying, oh no, Alaska's not melting. Well, move up there and tell those people that. The sea ice is melting. The polar bear is becoming to a point of extinction because he has to go out on the sea ice to find the seals to feed himself. And he can't get out on sea ice. So they're moving into towns, into civilized towns in Alaska, and eating out of their garbage cans and eating out of them great big dumpsters. The polar bears can't find any food because they can't get on the sea ice. And you don't have to believe me. Go home and Google it, and they'll tell you all about it. We use our computers for playing games instead of finding out all the information they give you. And then people will say, well, you can't believe everything the computer said. I told a woman one night down here at Kroger, I said, Christmas is pagan. And I wanted to make it easy for her. She said, well, where'd you get that? I said, well, you can find it on the computer. Well, computers are not always right. Well, I didn't tell her. I studied that for 50 years before they invented computers. Out of the Bible. But I didn't tell her. I thought, you're ignoramus. People will make an excuse for the judgment of God that's coming. Now look here in Revelation, the 18th chapter. I'm going to read. I need to set some of these things aside that I was going to read to you. They're talking about invasive species being everywhere. But look here what Revelation 18 says. Verse 2, there's an angel comes and cries, Babylon is fallen, is fallen. And he has become the habitation of devils. What lives in Babylon is D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. Daemonion, or demon, are distributors of fortunes. That's what inhabits Babylon. Come out. And he says up here in verse 4, I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people. Believers, come out of Babylon, quit participating in it, that ye be not partakers of her sins. If you put your approval on Babylonians, if anyone comes preaching into their doctrine, do not bid them Godspeed. If you bid them Godspeed, you're partaker of their evil deeds. He says, when you partake of their evil deeds, you'll partake of her plagues. He goes on down here and says, for her sins have reached into the heavens, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works. In the cup which she hath filled, filled her double. Give her twice as what she has given the world. How much she hath glorified and lived deliciously. The word deliciously in the Greek is the word strenos. When you're living after the flesh, you're living in a strain. When all you think of is self, how much money I can make, how much fame I can get, that's where I was. I used to live for fame and fortune. You're living in a strain. It's the greatest strain I was ever in. It nearly killed me in the hospital by the time I was 45. You're living in a strain. So much torment and sorrow give her, for she saith in her heart, I sent a queen, and am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. I love the way Babylon is described in the 47th chapter of Isaiah. I am, and none else beside me. I'm the only one that matters. That's the way you think. You're Babylonian, and God says, come out of her, my people. And what you're going to lose is all your things and stuff with all this heat. You can't get out of it. Nobody's going to get out of the judgment of God. If we're here and we don't die, we will remain under the coming of the Lord through all of this tribulation, such as was not from the beginning, no, nor ever shall be. Therefore, her plague shall come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. I believe that's the earth heating up. He doesn't mean he's going to burn the whole world. But he does say, seeing that the elements will melt with a fervent heat, what kind of persons ought we to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Look at that real quick over here. In second, we're talking about fire coming on the earth. Second Peter, verse 10. The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, but you're not the children of the darkness that day should overtake you as a thief, over there in 2 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter. Or 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, excuse me. Will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat. It actually, the word melt means, it's the word luo, dissolve. I've said this before. How will God melt everything? You've got, everything is made up of atoms. Atoms have a nucleus. They've got a, in the nucleus, they've got protons and neutrons. Protons have no charge. Protons have a positive charge. Neutrons have no charge. And the electrons that hold it all together, they have a negative charge. The negative charge of the electrons in the valence of the atom, everything you see is made up of this. Don't matter whether it's a cow pile out there in the field or it's a diamond ring on your finger. It's made of the same stuff. So if you want a cheap diamond ring, put some cow manure on your finger. Same thing. It just depends on what other atoms it connects with as to what it is. Well, all God would have to do is take the charges off those atoms and everything would melt. And who's holding them together? He is. It amazes me. I don't know why I can find these things and other people can't. And he says here, and where was I?
11.
Seeing these, then these things shall be dissolved. What manner of persons ought we to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of the God, wherewith the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt. That word melt, teko, means to liquefy. This is going to happen. Liquefy with fervent heat. Now back over here to Revelation. Back over to Revelation 18th chapter. Here's what's going to...
That next verse goes along with that. After the fervent heat, just telling us what we're looking for.
I can't hear you.
I said verse number 13
yeah.
tells us what we're looking for.
Yeah. Well, okay, I'll read that. Sometimes I'm just trying to get so many.
Yeah, I understand.
Nevertheless, we, according to His promise, look for a new heavens and new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Now go over here, back to Revelation 18. It's talking about all the things that you want in your life. When Babylon burns in the sea, I believe He's going to set this world, I believe there's going to prelude, be a prelude to setting the world on fire. I believe that we're going to see the heat, the earth heat up, and we're going to be suffering with it, people. It's not, I'm trying to tell you the truth. I'm not trying to scare you. I hope you are scared. Go home instead of watching your TV and watching movies. Go to your computer instead of playing games. Look up just any kind of sentence you want to. How the scientists view disasters, how they view the earth heating up or global warming, how they view the volcanoes or Alaska melting. They'll tell you all kinds of stuff, and people not interested in that. They want to play games. We got all the information we need on the internet. Look it up. And you have to be discerning who, when you're dealing with a, you'll have nutty people that'll curse the doomsday prophets. Well, the New Testament is a doomsday book. It's doomsday for the people that don't believe God. In Revelation 18, He says, the kings, look at verse, therefore shall be her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. In verse 8, for strong is the Lord God who judgeth, let us make us a name, or her. And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously are in a strain with her, shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning. And then He starts naming all the goodies of the first century. That would equate with all the goodies of our century. Here's what's going to happen with Babylon when it burns. Standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city Babylon, all our money and our stuff, the mighty city, for one an hour, in 1 hour is thy judgment come. And the merchants, the people who buy and sell of the earth, shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth their merchandise anymore, because they can't even put it together anymore for the heat. And it names a list of the best you could have in the first century. The merchandise of gold, that's still a good thing to have. And silver, that's still good. And precious stones, and pearls, and fine linen, and purple. Purple was hard to get. They would take purple off the coast of Tyre up here. There was a mollusk in the off the coast of Tyre, and they had one little, just a drop of purple in it, and that's where they got purple robes for the royal people. And if you got caught wearing purple and you weren't rich, they'd put you in jail till they could find out where you got that. Purple, that's why it's there. Lydia, when she met Paul on a creek bank in Acts 16, and God turned her heart around, she was a seller of purple. She dealt with kings every day, royalty. She gave up a good job to believe God. And purple, and silk, and scarlet, and all fine wood, and all manner of vessels of ivory, and that's still expensive. And all manner of vessels of most precious wood, and brass, and iron, and marble, and cinnamon, and odors, and ornaments, and frankincense, and wine, and oil. This was the best of the first century. If you were rich, you could buy all of this. Fine flour, wheat, and beast, and sheep, and horses, and chariots, and slaves, and souls of men, and the fruits that thy soul lusted after are departed from thee when Babylon burns. I believe that has to do with the literal Babylon that's going to be burning right here in the very, very near future. It may just be the heat that men curse God for bringing up on the earth. and they will not repent. And the fruits that thy soul lusted after are departed from thee, and all things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee, and thou shalt find them no more at all. It's not going to be there anymore when this great heat hits. They won't even be able to work. What do you think? How do you think men can work out there in 140 degrees? They can't. How can they go underground and bring up the coal? And how can they put together all of this finery that we've got? And how can they do anything without some kind of comfortable climate? The merchants of these things which were made rich by her shall stand afar off for fear in her torment, weeping and wailing and saying, alas, alas, that great city Babylon, the great mountain Babylon, that gives us the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. That's the mark of the beast. That was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls. This is not just the Catholic Church. This is everywhere you find, let us make us a name or self. For in 1 hour, so great riches has come to naught. In 1 hour means in a very short period of time can all fall. Proverbs 29:1 says, he that hardens his neck when he's often reproved shall be suddenly cut off, and that without remedy. When judgment of God comes, he may just rain it on us one day. I kind of expect every day to get up and look at the news and them to say, the stock market has fallen, there's no hope. Mr. Trump's not going to bring us out of this. This is the judgment of God that's here. For in 1 hour so great riches has come to naught, and every shipmaster. What if I said every FedEx? Every shipmaster and all the company and ships and sailors, that's how they ship their goods. It can be FedEx or anyone like that, the airlines. How about the postal service? And as many as trade by sea stood afar off, that's the way they ship their goods. And cried when they saw the smoke of Babylon's mountain burning, saying, what city is like unto this great city? And they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, alas, that great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea. Ships in the sea just means their way of shipping. It's not a mysterious thing. That's how they sent things long distance. They didn't have FedEx or the Postal Service or what?
Airplanes.
Or any of the rest of them. They were made rich that had the ships in the sea by reason of her costliness, for in 1 hour, a very short period of time, it can happen overnight. Is she made desolate? Rejoice over her that hath thou heaven, and ye apostles and prophets, for God has revenged you on her. He's broken her. And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone, and cast it into the sea. Destruction. That's what it meant. Am I out of time?
Yeah.
But he goes on to say, thus with violence shall they, that great city Babylon, be thrown down and shall be found no more at all. That means all the goodies that you want, the new car, the new house, it's all gone. Food, you can't even find that. And he goes on to say, the voice of harpers and musicians and rock singers and country singers and of pipers and trumpeters shall be heard no more at all in thee, and no craftsman or whatever craft in building all these big fine homes on the lake and building some big house up here in the mountains, some big chalet. And he be shall be found any more in thee, and the sound of millstone. No more food shall be heard in thee no more at all, and the light of a candle shall shine no more at all in thee, and the voice of the bridegroom and the bride, there'll be no more marriages. It's over. This is the end. God says, we're going to lead up to it. I'm going to have to stop here. But he goes on to say, for thy merchants were the great men of the earth. For the For by thy sorceries were all nations deceived. By your smooth talk. And in her was found the blood of the prophets and of the saints and all that was slain upon the earth. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for truth. Let us see that this is what's happening in the world. Let the people here see this. Help them to understand that our commitment needs to be to you and living righteously for you. And not for things and stuff. Lord, that's been our problem. It's just self. Help us to see there is no way out. You say there's no way out. Some of these scientists say the same thing. Some of these economic scholars say it. Lord, let people understand that your word is the last word. Help us to commit to you, live righteously in your truth. And we'll give you praise for all things in Christ's name. Amen. I feel like we barely touched that. Oh. Are you going to look this up on the internet?
Yeah.
Look up.
I look up stuff all the time.
Just look up anything on natural disasters throughout the world.
Sorry, I got Pleiades and Orion backwards.
What are you
doing? Can I have some juicy food?
Huh? I can't hear you.
Can I have some?
Oh, yeah, sure. Let's see if I can find some. Can y'all have gum? Your mother let you have gum? Huh? Can y'all have gum? Your mother don't mind?
No, thanks.
Okay, here, take one for sis. Take one to her. You take one to Jonathan. I don't feel...
Jonathan isn't here today.
Huh?
Jonathan's sick.
Oh, he is. We'll take it home to him.
Huh? Can I get a signature from you?
Put that, my X on there.
Yeah, your X on there.
My key.
Your key.
My key.
You did, okay.
Yeah, I've been real depressed over the world lately. I feel like I'm doing such an injustice to this. I don't feel like I'm doing what needs to be done on it. I just really don't.
Well, but there's hope, you know.
Huh?
It's hope for the believers in this world.
Yeah. I'm real depressed at what's going on. I don't care how nice the weather is. People not believing God is a part of the end.
Yeah, that's true.
People not believing God, Israel, mm-hmm. Everything they're talking about, the terrorism, that's men fighting men. And there's no end to it.
There's not. No.
It makes me sad every day that people, very few people call me for Elements War on TV. Even if they don't like what I preach or the way I preach, something I'm saying, it's all the things that thy soul lusteth after, that's what's keeping them away. I'm talking about believers. It's keeping the believers away. Believers are going to have, they're going to have to suffer. Maybe this thing will get so bad before it's over with that they'll start saying, I've got to repent. There's no time for fights and fusses. No time for that. This thing is crucial. I don't have time to fight anybody. I'm just trying to get the message out. I witness every day before I go. And once in a while, I run across somebody and say, "Boy, that's really good. Yeah, I really like that." I don't hear from them. Maybe because they're living in a world.